AJ, can you talk about the decision to let Reese make a traditional start versus?
I don't want to bore you guys. You know, it's just part. You know, we know he's going to face this team for the second time. He's made a ton of starts for us. He's really good. And part of his routine, we don't want to interrupt again. You know, I think the challenge is always when you do as many openers as we've done and use as many guys as we have, it always brings up the question if you should do it all the time. But we really believe in Reese. We liked the way he threw the ball the other day. Does let them set their lineup. They did, and now we'll react accordingly. But it's okay to have a regular start by somebody not named Tarik Skubal, and we'll be ready to go.
AJ, do you feel like Reese had to shake off any rust after he got back from the IL, and how important was it to see him go several innings in his last start?
Yeah, the last start was his best start since he came off, and I don't think it was necessarily rust as much as it was building up his endurance, you know, in the middle of the competition. You know, we activated him pretty early after his rehab assignment started. He didn't really get built up as a starter for – I think he only threw a couple innings in the minor leagues. So we were trying to do both things the last 10 days of the season and use his innings to get into the playoffs and then hopefully continue to build him up to where his endurance is up to 75 to 100 pitches. So the other day when he came in, it was an ideal circumstance. He'd never really inherited a runner like that before. He ends up giving up a homer on his first pitch, and then he settled in and was able to not only build his endurance, but be pretty good through the lineup. So it's part of up until probably his last outing, it was all part of his rehab assignment. Happened to be in important games in a playoff race, which is sort of unheard of.
Questions? I was just curious. We didn't get a chance to ask you last night about the crowd. The vibe and how you think that might have helped.
Yeah, it was great to have October baseball back in Detroit, and our fans delivered. I mean, it was an incredible environment. The orange towels were legit. The timing of the noise, the end of the game, the vibe around the club, the excitement and introductions. I thought it was all, appropriately dynamic and positive. I mean, it was an environment our guys continued to talk about throughout the day and into the night, and it was good to see Comerica at its best, and it's because of the fans in this city and the patience they've shown to get October baseball back in Detroit. I mean, they delivered.
AJ, from a pitching perspective, you guys obviously mix and match based on advantageous matchups, but just like the way they've kind of deployed their bench throughout this series, do you notice an extra layer of preparation to how you kind of strategically map out your pitching?
Yeah, so they have the platoon advantage almost all the time. I mean, it's hard to get the matchup with them, and if you are, you're getting Stephen Kwan against lefties. That is not a great recipe, or you're getting Naylor the guys that stay in the lineup a ton regardless of handedness. And with Jose in the middle, who gets all of his at-bats that way, it's a dynamic lineup to get through and continue to attack. You know, I think one of the things that we preach against lineups like this is getting the opposite-handed hitter out. And that's really hard against these guys because, like I said, you never can guarantee yourself, even with how they use their pinch hitters and they use their bench as much as anybody. So opposite-handed attack plans are really important against these guys, and we spend just as much time on that as we do, trying to get our guys to pitch to their strengths when they have the advantage. It's hard, and I think that the thing that in a five-game series, trying not to give these guys a second look at the same pitcher over and over. And it's hard. Bo Brisky's throwing the ball great. Is he going to face the same guys today? You never know. Will Vest, same thing. Tyler Holton, starts a game, closes a game. Pretty good chance he's in the middle of this game somewhere. So we talk a lot more about that than specifically, how they're shaping their lineup or what they're doing. And we know They can do a lot of different things to your pitching staff because of the versatility of their lineup.
Question about where Matt Vierling was playing for that line drive. Mm-hmm. How much of that was scouting and analytics? How much of that instincts and his own decision making?
Probably a little bit of both. We spend a lot of hours, you know, and a lot of people in the organization spend a lot of hours going over positioning. Joey Cora does a tremendous job of challenging the information and making sure that those instincts come into play. And so to the pull side with Fry, you know, your question depends on the pitch. It depends on which pitcher is there. You get a lefty with a cutter. Sometimes you play to the pull side. You get Will Vest throwing the ball hard down and in with the sinker. He'll take a few steps to his pull side. You know, there's you know, you never want to lose either side of that question. You don't want to lose the information. You don't want to lose the instincts. And when both come together, you get a big out at a big moment in the game.
AJ, obviously things can be a little unconventional in the postseason. Have you ever considered, or would you ever consider, using Skubal in relief in a tight situation late?
Today?
Yes.
No chance.
Okay.
And Jason in the back corner?
I shouldn't tell Steven that, though. Maybe he will.
You mentioned, you know, hitters having a second look at pitchers in the same series. To flip that, how much did that factor into how you laid out your lineup for this game with the second look at Bybee? I think it's the
same lineup
in order you put up for game one.
Yeah, I mean, I thought we had pretty good at-bats against him, and he won the big at-bats. And this is, what, the sixth or seventh time we faced him this year. You know, and McKinstry is a good example who's had pretty good success against him, you know, throughout this season. So he's back in there again today. And you know, I think there's always the curiosity on whether to mix things up or it's hard to sit Wenzel Perez, but he hasn't had great success against Bybee. And you go back to, if you really break down the last game, I thought our bats were very competitive. We didn't get the two out hit. We put pressure on him early where we thought they may even have to go to their bullpen earlier than they wanted to. He got out of it. And then he settled in until they took the ball away from him and gave it to their bullpen. So, I'm going to go with the same lineup because I like the quality of the bats that were there and the advantage for the hitter of seeing somebody for the same time in 5 days is sometimes good, sometimes irrelevant. We're hoping for the good side.
AJ, from an outside perspective, it seems like you have an ego-less team here. I mean, yesterday, Carey was the hero on Monday, gets pinch hit for yesterday. Your bullpen always is evolving. Where does that stem from and where does that come from and how hard is it to create that in a professional environment?
Yeah, I mean, we do have the definition of a team. You know, I mean, up and down this lineup, up and down the pitching staff. I'm so happy with how we can deploy our guys at their strengths and their best, and the player buy-in has been the single biggest impact on this entire team. It's probably a little unusual. You know, everybody wants their moment. But we have high-character guys that are willing to do anything that you can. I mean, we have a lot of capable guys, but we have a lot of guys who are willing, you know, to take a seat if the next guy has a better advantage. And, you know, I think the player buy-in is the number one key. The players have to go out and believe that that's the right strategy for us to maximize our abilities. And I'm very appreciative of it, and I see it in action every day. You know, Cater Montero comes out after six pitches. You know, he's got everybody back home watching. The whole world's watching this playoff start, and he comes out of the game, and he's on the top step yelling for his teammate that he played with in Double-A in Erie when Brant Herder comes in. Kerry Carpenter, who's going to get his moment against the lefty. It may be tonight. It may be tomorrow. It may be, you know, later if we continue to play on. Understands that Jahan has every bit of shot to do something special, and so he stays on the top step. I've done it for Torque. He's homered after the day after I've hit for him. Andy Ibañez waits and waits and waits and waits, helmet on, batting gloves on, bat in hand, ready for a left-handed pitcher. If it doesn't come, he's the biggest cheerleader on the field. If it does, he goes up and gets a game-winning hit. So the players are incredible on this team, and the buy-in is special, and I think it's part of the reason that we're doing special things.
Hey, Bo, when you think back to spring training and the kind of season you had envisioned for yourself and the roles you were expecting to fill, when you reflect back on all the different roles you filled this season, what do you think about?
Basically that I've always just tried to be a pitcher and not really think about what role I think I should be in or what suits me best. I just feel like if I go out there and make the pitches, it'll allow for me to be flexible, and that's kind of what you aim for. I don't want to be thought of as a single type of pitcher. I just want to be a pitcher and allow the manager to use me however he sees fit, and I feel like that's kind of the way that I wanted to approach things, and so that's the way I went into camp.
Kind of building on that, just what's your mentality out there, knowing that you could be called on early in the game, late in the game? Just what's the mental preparation to get yourself ready, knowing that you could come in at any given time?
Really just not trying to do too much out there and just staying calm, staying ready, because I don't want to be on edge from pitch one. I want to be able to kind of sit back and watch the game, relax, enjoy the game until I see something happened in the game where I feel like there might be some movement, and then we kind of have a, depending on which day it is, like when Scooble's starting, for instance, I kind of know that the early innings of the game I'm not going to be needing to get ready, needing to come in, so that'll be more of the prepare for the later innings. Game like yesterday, I knew that Herter was going to be coming into the game after Montero. And then from there, we'll see, be ready. And so just kind of taking the game as it comes and locking in when I feel like I need to, just trying to – we've been doing it for a while, so I kind of – we're starting to learn AJ and the way that he likes to deploy the guys out there in the pen.
Questions? Inside, Chris?
But we know how hard you've worked on your slider mm-hmm. a lot. And can you just talk about the evolution of that pitch and how – like prouder or happy you are with it right now? There, I mean, AJ refers to it as a turbo slider now, and you've gotten some big outs with it. Mm-hmm. Just the evolution of that pitch and where it's at now.
I think a big thing for me is that when I'm throwing, the catchers have the confidence to call it in big spots. So I think that gives you confidence as a pitcher that it's a good pitch, because obviously they're not gonna call something that they don't think can get outs. So I always look at it as, okay, there's got to be a reason that he's seeing something, and it's my job to execute it. And I also feel like when I do execute that pitch, it is the last piece to the arsenal, kind of fills in everything, and it helps everything complement and put my arsenal together. So, yeah, when that pitch is going and when the catchers are calling it and we're setting it up properly, I think it helps me get through lineups a little bit easier.
Jordan, over here. Oh, in the middle.
But when you think back to when you were drafted, and over the last 5 years, you know, a lot of us are getting to know a lot of you Tigers pitchers mm-hmm. over these last few months. Was there a point coming up through the minor leagues when you kind of looked around and realized the kind of arm talent that was surrounding you, and now that you're doing it together on the biggest stage, what that's been like?
Yeah, I don't think you really know until you get to the big leagues, because there's always that feeling of it's the unknown, and you see guys in the minor leagues that are good, and you're like, wow, that's a good pitcher, but no one knows how their stuff is going to work when we get here. But I think what I really remember was coming into camp this year after a few years of already being at this level. Coming into camp this year, everyone was looking around saying, wow, I mean, so it's the largest group of quality pitchers we've ever seen. And everyone had agreed on that. And it was pretty exciting, because there was guys that were starting in Double-A that were good pitchers this year. And that's just kind of a testament to the depth that we have. And it's now some of those guys are here. So that was the way that we looked at it, and definitely seems to be true.
Well, I think back to spring training when I think we talked about what you were working on with the slider and how much research you put into how you wanted that pitch to be. How much is the pitch you throw now an outgrowth of that, and how much did you go further with it?
That is, it's kind of funny because as the season evolves and as your mechanics kind of evolve as the season goes on, you're pitching a little bit more tired and you're kind of adapting to the stresses of the year. I feel like pitch shapes change a little bit for guys, and that's why you can see how there has to be so many adjustments that are necessary throughout a year to be able to have continued success. So there was adjustments for me on multiple pitches that I throw this year, just because I didn't like the way that they were feeling or the way that they were performing, and that was definitely one of them. And kind of just making tweaks so that it feels good really is the main key and the main factor. I don't really worry about trying to do like a pitch design type change in the middle of the season. It's more of just what feels good for me and what do I feel like I can execute on a consistent basis.
Bo, this is the third time in like 2 weeks that you guys are one more win away from doing something special. I'm just curious, today, does it feel the same as any of the other before? And how do you guys manage to just keep it business as usual when you guys continue to climb higher and higher and higher?
I think it feels the same, yeah. I don't think that there has been any difference in the way that guys have came in and approached this day. I think everyone knows, but I think the reason that we've been able to get to this point in general is just because guys are out there having fun and playing free. And I don't know, I think of really, because it was also my view, but I think back to the play that Vierling made, and I just, that kind of just is an encompassing play for the way that we have gone about this whole run. Is just, if you need to make a play, someone does it. And if you need to make a pitch, someone makes it. And that is really just, it just sums up the way that we've gone about this. And guys are stepping up, and I feel like guys are going to continue to step up.
Good. Hey, without talking the strategy talk of it, but can you kind of take us inside the pitcher meetings when you have bulk, I know this is not a day, but a bulk reliever day, are all the pitchers in there? Or is it still just you, Fett, and the opener? Or how does the dynamic of that work when you know there's going to be multiple pitchers?
So they have a big meeting before every series, and they go over all the, in a bulk, the whole bullpen kind of goes over all their hitters with Fetter and the pitching staff and all the bullpen guys. And obviously the guys that might come in later will be a part of that, meeting. You know, the herders, the Olsen, you know, whoever might come in after. And then the starter or the opener or the bolt guy or whatever we're planning on doing that day will meet with me and Fetter, and we'll go over their lineup, you know, all their weaknesses, stuff like that. But yeah, mainly it's all the bullpen kind of has their own meeting, and then whoever's starting that day or opening that day will have a meeting with me and Fett, or whoever's going to get the bulk is going to be the meeting with me and Fett to go over those hitters.
Jake, I mean, you work with Fett and those guys as closely as the pitchers do. What do you think it is about Chris and Robin and Juan that have helped optimize so many different guys this season?
Oh, man. First of all, they're great at their job. I truly believe that. And I think all the guys believe that, which, you know, trust is a big thing in this game, and it goes a long way. I work with them very closely, and I think all three of them are different, which, you know, helps out every single guy. Everyone has a different personality, and those three guys have all three different personalities, and some guys cling to others and go to others more than the others. Fett, and then they get the best out of everybody, I think, just with the plans and their usages and stuff like that, you know, coming up and you know, their off season work going into the spring training. I think that's kind of what they've done really well, is kind of get the best out of everybody. And, you know, because most of these guys have came up and have, you know, maybe gone up and down in years past, or kind of hadn't figured out who they are, and here they are being incredible. Every single one of them has done a great job. But yeah, I think, you know, Fett kind of brings, you know, the pitching, and Lundy is, you know, I mean, just incredibly smart. Said some stuff where I'm like, you got to put that in West Texas terms. And then, you know, Juan had been around the game for so long. He's got that baseball part of him. So yeah, I think that's kind of, it helps all our guys kind of, you know, truly become who they need to be.
On that note, you know, those three guys have different personalities. This whole bullpen has different personalities, and you're kind of the epitome of gone are the days where catchers are just paired with single pitchers. How have you been able to this season maintain as much uniformity as possible and maybe the method to your madness of game calling when you're working with different guys coming up on the mound at any given time?
Yeah, I mean, truly just gotten to know all these guys. That's, you know, kind of a catcher's job is to kind of know every single one of them and, you know, what they like, if they like to be, you know, a slap on the butt or a slap in the face, you know, whatever they kind of like and don't like, you kind of have to learn that. And I think, you know, all these guys, like you said, are different. And I think just kind of the build up and the relationship that we've had throughout the years, and a lot of these guys, you know, that have come up that I haven't really caught a lot, and talking to, you know, because I talked to Dingler because he caught a lot of these guys in the minor leagues, and talking to Dingler and kind of figuring out who these guys are as quick as possible when they came up a couple months ago or, you know, whenever they came up. But yeah, I think it's just, you know, kind of my responsibility to kind of get to know all these guys. And I think, you know, just building that relationship has helped me a lot, you know, with their pitch calling and stuff like that. But.
Hey, Jake, I asked Bo when he kind of realized the true potential of this pitching staff. He mentioned this spring training as being a time when he looked around and realized how deep this group was. What's been your perspective as someone who's been here for a while of the evolution of this group into what it is today?
Yeah, it's a good point. I mean, we looked around the room in spring, and we were like, man, we're gonna be a good team. And, you know, with the whole bullpen, I think a lot of those guys are coming back for their second years. You know, the three or four guys that kind of have been a part of it for the last couple years, been like, man, these guys are good. You know, with Holton and Foley and Brisky, Vest, just guys that I've kind of known the last couple years. And, you know, we trust in those guys. And obviously, you know, I think we trust in a lot of those guys in the bullpen now. But yeah, spring training was a big moment of, like, looking around the room going, like, man, this is not going to be an easy team to make, especially for the pitching staff. They had some tough choices to make out of camp. I'm glad I didn't have to make those decisions, and AJ made them. And, you know, I think every single one of these guys that didn't even – and he says it, AJ said it in spring training. There's some guys in here that you think you're not going to make an impact, you're going to be a part of it, and here they are making an impact and are every part of, you know, why we're winning today. But yeah, it was an early call this year of going like, man, it's going to be a good team. And obviously we had our downs, and you know, we didn't, you know, obviously behind 500, just trying to catch up to 500. And then here we are, a win away from the ALCS. So you just kind of never know. And baseball is a crazy game.
Jake, how have you seen Brisky's slider come along and evolve since, you know, the start of the season? And what has that done for his game?
Oh, man. I mean, he's got all his pitches are great. He's got 4-plus pitches. And the slider just kind of evolving to what it is today. I mean, obviously he's got the 98 in the back pocket. And I think he kind of uses his slider well to play off of it. You know, the saying is like using your misses kind of deal. You know, just being able to throw the slider down and away for a righty, and then, you know, throw 98 down and away like he has been, you know, all year, really, is really a positive for him. And he's done a really good job of just kind of being able to mix those pitches and use those pitches wisely. I think in the past, he was leaving the slider up, and it was kind of the only pitch that righties were kind of able to catch up to and hit, and he was giving up some damage on it. And I think just being able to, you know, locate that a little better, and, you know, being able to throw it off the plate and then, you know, playing a heater right off of it has made him grow.
Hey, Jake, yesterday you said you've seen the ballpark totally empty and you saw it like it was yesterday and you would take yesterday every time. Mm. You've been here since 2019.
Yep.
I'm sure you've, like, fantasized about what this would be like. Does this live up to the hype? Is it better than the hype?
Oh, man, I don't know. I think it's better. It was, like I said it a million times yesterday, it seems like, but it was an incredible atmosphere, and I was sure to soak it all in. And I'm telling everybody to try to soak all in because it was awesome. Yeah, I mean, you know, 19 was a rough year for the Tigs, and you know, we lost a lot of games and not a lot of fans wanted to come, which I don't blame them. But yeah, I mean, fans have been through a lot. I've been through a lot, but yeah, I mean, yesterday was all we've wanted. It's all you ever kind of work for as a player, I'm sure, as a fan too. You know, you come to the ballpark to watch an incredible game and hopefully your team wins. But yeah, I think that's everything you want as a player and to be a part of that kind of atmosphere. And again, I was glad I'm part of it.